Hello everyone. Today we are going to discuss a recent paper called Lightweight Contextual Spelling Correction Model for Customizing Transducer Based Speech Recognition System. And this paper is coming from Microsoft. The overview is as follows. First we'll look at the introduction of the paper. Then we'll see what is contextual spelling correction. And we'll see experiments, and finally we'll see the results. First of all, what is what is contextual spelling correction model? Before going there, let's understand how recent speech recognition system, or how the deep learning based speech recognition systems are provided with contextual information. Why do we need to provide contextual information, you may ask? So there are many reasons. For example, let's say you are using telephone service, right? And you want to transcribe the telephonic call and telephone call, and in the call you may mention your name, and you may mention your address, your company name, and so on. And those words or those phrases will not be present during training of the model. They may be present or they may not be. And in order to make sure the ASR model spits out those kinds of word, you have to use an extra or an additional trick. You have to use some additional tricks. I'll tell you what those additional tricks are, and there are many ways to do this. So imagine you have a speech recognition system, and imagine your speech recognition system is trained on thousands and thousands of hours of audio data. So it has very good acoustic, the acoustic model is very strong, and the accuracy of the acoustic model is very good. But the thing is, the model works really well on normal words, but when you talk, or when you say your name, or your address, or place name, and so on, those may not be captured, because the instances of the probability of those instances or the words present during training is very less, right? So they may, those words may not be even present during training. So that's why the model will be the model is not so accurate in predicting those kind of words, right? So how do they do that? So what you can do is, you can create a contextual LM model. So when I say contextual LM model, so imagine you have some text data where the names and the address and all those things are spoken, and you take the text data and build a language model, right? And that is a contextual language model specific to that particular domain, and you can use that during decoding, right? And that's a simple way. And sometimes it works, sometimes it may not work, but this paper proposes a different approach. So first of all, as I said, this is what is contextual, providing contextual information to the ASR model. So the main reason is, we want to make sure the model predicts some of the important words which are not present during training, or sometimes also known as OOV words, out of vocabulary words. And you have to guide the model in order to predict those kind of information, either using language model or using the techniques which I'm going to explain to you in this paper, right? And in this paper they use something called spelling correction model. Spelling correction models are becoming famous these days in speech recognition community. So you can check out spelling correction models. I think this trend started in 2019. First paper came out from Google, and then a couple of other companies also started proposing these ideas on spelling correction model. So I'll explain what is spelling correction model, so don't worry about that. So it's very simple. It's a encoder decoder approach, just like a machine translation model. So in case of machine translation, you have text, you have a text in one language and the output will be in another language, right? In this case, you are feeding text, which is the output from the ASR, and the ASR output will be erroneous, because it will have some spelling mistakes if you are using CTC specifically, and it may not have your contextual words, right? And you make sure the model predicts in the decoder the contextual words, and this is the spelling correction model, right? And this paper actually obtains significant improvement over the baseline approaches in capturing these OOV words or contextual words, right, or contextual phrases. And we will see the results, and results are really good. So that's why I thought of explaining this paper. I think this is I think people who are working in speech recognition, specifically people who are working in speech recognition in industry specifically, they face these kind of issues, because I have been working in speech recognition industry for a long time, and I know companies, when they build speech recognition engines, they actually want these kind of features where they can predict contextual information, because those are the main important information they need, instead of predicting normal words. So normal words, you can use this recent wave to wake, or you can even train a large model and get the proper output, or get a very low word rate on those sentences. But this is the because this is the real deal. If you can predict the context information properly, because that will have most of the information of the call, right, or the audio, whatever application you are using in speech recognition. So this is not the first paper. People have proposed ideas like this in the past also, like I said, contextual language model. You can directly use contextual language model, or you can use, like, there are other approaches such as contextual listen, attendance, spell, and so on. And I think this paper is good in terms of two ways. One is, it does it shows how to reduce the model size so that you can deploy it, and second is, it gets much better accuracy compared to previous approaches. Now let's look at the contextual spelling correction model. So imagine you have a speech recognition engine here, right, and you provide your audio. It can be any kind of model. So in this case, it's RNN transducer model. It can be any type of ASR model you can assume. You can go with, say, wave to vec, you can go with like transformer model, or you can go with anything, encoder decoder approach, like sequence and so on, right? So once you do the decoding, or once you feed the audio, you will get the output, right? So the output will be some words, sequence of words, right? And if you don't do language model, if you don't add language model, your output may be erroneous, meaning if I say, let's say I am going to school, that's the sentence I spoke, but the model kind of missed out N here and H here, right? So that means these two words are wrong. Now, in order to correct that, what you do, you just add a language model on top of it, so that the language model will correct it for you, right? But in this case, they are not going to add language model here. So they're going to feed this output into a encoder. So you have this encoder, you have the decoder, right? So sequence model, like I said. So the ASR hypothesis is the output from the speech recognition model. You feed it to the encoder, then you get sequence of embeddings, right, from the encoder, right? This is standard. If you have 10 words, you get 10 vectors here. Not really 10 vectors. If you are tokenizing your sentences into, if you are using token word level tokenizer, you will get it. But if you are using, let's say, subwords and so on, this is different. But imagine you are using word level, so you get 10 vectors here. Now the question is, how are we going to add contextual information, right? So in order to correct this sentence, you can simply use this encoder, and you know the ground truth, because you know what is the actual output of the ground truth sentence, or the ground truth target for the sentence, and you can make sure this decoder predict this correct sentence, and you can train it end to end, so that the encoder decoder approach will solve these errors for you. But that is not the only problem we want to solve here. We also want to solve the contextual, or we also want to introduce contextual information into this model, right? So how do we do that? Very simple. You take the context. So context will be list of sentences or phrases, right? Not exactly sentences, the phrases, and it will have all sorts of context you want. Let's say you are dealing with political data or political domain data. And usually in the political domain, people talk about the prime ministers and their names, for example, Joe Biden and Donald Trump and so many other folks, and some other politics related words as well, right? There could be phrases as well, right? Election, these kind of words, right? So all these phrases will be in this in a list. What you can do is you take this list of phrases and feed it to the encoder and extract sequence of vectors or the embeddings from the encoder output, and then you aggregate them by using mean or averaging, aggregate all the or average all the vectors and get a single vector representation for each phrase, right? If you have let's say 1000 phrases, you get 1000 vectors here, right? Now during decoding, you attend to both the output from the encoder, which is for this sentence, and this context list, and decode your output, right? So that way the model will have information, or somehow you are providing information to this encoder decoder model and telling or guiding the model to predict correct contextual information, right? That is the idea of this contextual spelling correction model, right? You have spelling correction model, people have proposed it before, which was this only this encoder and decoder, but now you have added your context also. Now you can ask me a question, okay, why is the arrow going here, which shows that the encoder here and the encoder for the context, they are shared, means you are using a single encoder in order to reduce the number of parameters and so on. So that's what the claim of this paper is. So to reduce the number of parameters, you are using a single encoder or shared encoder for both ASR hypothesis and context list, right? And then you do the decoding. So that's all, that's the whole idea of this paper, but we will see some of the tricks they use during inferencing, which is important, right? So we'll see those things in the coming slide, and also we'll see some of the training tricks training tricks and augmentation tricks they are using, because you need to have data to in order to train this model, right? So it's difficult to get this kind of data, like contextual data, unless you have labels, like unless you have human annotators who can go and annotate. But this paper uses a clever trick to synthesize the data using text-to-speech engine, and we'll see how, right? So this is the training training section where I'm going to explain it in four different parts. So first they have text-to-speech, we'll see why. Then they have data augmentation, contextual setup, and teacher-student learning. Now what is text-to-speech? So as you know, text-to-speech is given a text, the model should generate audio, right? So in order to generate, or in order to create a data set for this application, for this kind of models, you need some label data, which means you need an audio or a sentence which has the context, right? And contextual phrase in it, and also it should be a sentence, particular sentence, right? So what they do is very simple. So they say, okay, do I have any emails from today, right? So from today, and you can introduce all the names of the people, or all the names of the which are present in the context list, right? So that way you get, let's say if you have 10 names, and you can use this sentence and introduce 10 names, like you'll get 10 times of this sentence, right? And once you have this sentence, now you need the audio for this sentence. So for that you use a text to speech engine. So you create these kind of sentences, then you generate audios using TTS engine, and once you generate the audio, now you have the audio, right? And you have the transcript, which is this, right? And now you can do the training very easily. You feed this to RNNT, get the ASR hypothesis, feed it to this spelling correction model, and then generate the output, right? Simple. This is the text-to-speech part. So data augmentation, in case of data augmentation, I mean, you may have 10,000 or 20,000 names. You may not be able to get long or very large amount of data for training. So they have to do some augmentation techniques. So what they do is they take a sentence, for example, you are right here, and they replace this right by some random words like Bob, Bobby, and so on, right? and that way they can double or triple the data set size, right? I mean, it may destroy the grammar as they are saying here, but they are saying it won't affect the results, right? So let's read from here. It's not affecting the performance much. Okay, coming to the contextual setup. So you may ask me a question. Okay, you may have, let's say, 50,000 phrases in your context list, and how are you going to do the training? So you can't feed 50,000 sentences every time to the encoder and run the attention over those 50,000 phrases, right? So that is very difficult during training. So what they do is they randomly sample NC number of context phrases, and NC could be 100, for example, in our case, right? And they uniformly sample from the list of context, and N max is in NC max is our number of the context size. Context list size means total number of context phrases we have, right? And you can't just use the phrases, context sentences during training. You also have to add normal sentences as well. So what they do is they use some probability to mix both contextual sentences or sentences which are context phrases and sentences which do not have context phrases, right? So that's how you balance the batch, right? Now this is just an example. So ASR hypothesis is like this: who is Alyssa Friedman, right? And in the context you have the names of all the politicians, right? So like Trump, Alyssa Friedman, Joe Biden, normal people as well. They may not be always politicians, but names of the people, right? Now, and the reference is who is Alyssa Friedman, means the original or the ground truth of this sentence or the ground truth of this audio is actually Alyssa Friedman, but the model, ASR model, somehow predicted it as Alyssa Friedman, right? So means we have to replace this Alyssa by Alyssa, right? So what you do is during training you tell the model, I mean, you want this is the context word, right? Context phrase. So yeah, because this is in the context list, right? So you have to put this symbol in order to tell the model where you want to replace, right? So that is one more contextual setup trick. And finally, coming to teacher student learning, this is done in order to reduce the size of the model, because since the models are encoder decoder, and you will be using tens of layers of transformer, for example, right? I mean, or RNN maybe, I mean, not exactly transformer. So you may be using LSTMs and deep LSTMs and so on. So you if you want to deploy it into some framework, or if you want to run it faster, you need to have a smaller model size. You have to reduce the model size so that you can serve many people and run it faster, right? So clever trick to use for that is teacher student learning, where you transfer the knowledge of a teacher, which is a big model, or to a student, which is a small model, and during this transfer of knowledge you have to retain the accuracy of the overall system, right? So I mean, the student should be able to do as good as the teacher. If not as good as you, it may have a little bit reduction in accuracy, or accuracy may reduce a little bit, but you still have a very small model, right? And how do you do that? Very simple. You first just add the hard loss and soft loss. So here L hard is basically loss which is calculated using that student network, means this H here is a student, right? So what you do is you feed your input to the student, and the student will predict some output, right? Ys, and your ground truth is Y, right? And you compute the loss, and the loss could be cross entropy, and this is your L hard loss, right? I mean, let me write it here. I mean, you can understand. So you have this teacher, right? T, and you have your student student S, right? What you do is you feed your input to this model, right? And input in the sense, in our case, it's text, right? And or let's call it as Y, and the teacher is going to spit out some output, right? So X, you feed X, the teacher is going to spit out some output, and let's call this as YT, right? And if you feed input to this student network, the same X, it will spit out some output called YS, right? If you want to transfer knowledge from this model to this model, you have to use this output, which is just distribution of words. At every word, every time shape, it's a probability distribution of the words, right? So that is that's why it's called soft, because it's probability distribution, not exactly the index, right? So you take this YT and just use temperature parameter in order to in the softmax, right? So once you get this output from the teacher, and if you have the output from the student, you just find out the KL divergence. Means what I want to do is I want to make sure the student network predicts same probability distribution as the teacher, right? What does it mean? How do you do that? So you are trying to make the two distributions similar or two distribution closer, and obvious metric you can use is the KL divergence, because KL divergence measures the distance between two distributions, right? If the distance is lower, means the two distributions are similar, otherwise it is not similar. So in this case, I have the output YT and I want to make sure this output YT is similar to, or output YS is similar to YT. So I'm going to minimize the distribution between these two, minimize the distance between these two distributions. So that's why you have this TKL term here, right? And that is the soft loss. And in order to find the hard loss, you can simply use the original ground or original targets, and then take the output from the student, and then compute the hard loss, which is just a cross entropy loss, for example, right? And then add the two losses. Now once you optimize the network, this model will be able to do as good as the teacher, and it may do better than teacher, or it may have a little bit lower accuracy compared to teacher. But one thing we make sure is this model is much smaller than this model, right? This model will be, let's say, of 2 layers of LSTM, and this could be 6 layers of LSTM. This is about teacher student learning. Now coming to the inference, use multiple classifiers and rankers to in order to make sure you are feeding the correct sentence to the spelling correction model. What do I mean by that? Let's say you have an utterance, right, sentence, and you want to generate output, or you want to you have some audio and you want to transcribe it, right? Let's say you feed it to that RNNT, and RNNT gives you some hypothesis, right? Hypothesis in the sense it gives you some sequence of words, right? Now the question is, should I feed that output to the spelling correction model or not? Because if it has the context, then it makes sense to feed it to the spelling correction model. Let's write it here. So we have the speech recognition model, right, ASR, and you feed your audio, right? And you get some output, and this output may have context word and may not have context word. If it has context words, which means you have to feed it to the spelling correction model in order to refine this context. If the audio does not have any context, it makes sense to just take it as it is, right? So for that, they use the pattern classifier, which tells you whether to feed into this or not, right? And relevance ranker, basically what it does is, in order to rank the number of, or rank the context phrases, they use this relevance ranker method. So basically you don't want to use all the context words when you are doing inference on a single sentence, right? Because most of them, almost 95 or 99% of the context sentences or context phrases will not be present in that particular sentence. So only some of them will be present, some of the words may be present. So you have to make sure your context list you are feeding to the spelling correction model has those context phrases, right? So that's why what you do is you compute rank, or you rank all your phrases, and you only take few of them, only the top ones, so that your inference is faster. So how do you do that? Very simple. You take the output which is from the decoder, and then you take the context phrase, and you find the edit distance between those two, and then you want to minimize, or you want to find out the sentences which have minimum edit distance, and you also normalize by the length of the phrase, right? And then you get the score, and using that score you just rank your context phrase and only take the top few of them and use them during the decoding, right? And that is one relevance ranker. And how do you do the decoding? Decoding is very simple, right? So you take the ASR hypothesis. This is one also another trick. So basically your ASR will generate sequence, will generate multiple hypotheses for a single utterance, right? So let's say you have 10 hypotheses for a given utterance, and H1, H2 are the hypotheses from the ASR model, right? And for each hypothesis, you can feed each hypothesis into the context, the spelling correction model, and get again n CSC number of hypotheses, right? Because this is also a decoder. You have decoder here, you have decoder here. So you can just use beam search and get top 10 hypotheses, right? So that means for every hypothesis from the ASR, you can generate n number of hypotheses from the spelling correction model, which means totally you will have n ASR into n CSC number of hypotheses, and you just select the ones which are giving you the best results using this equation, right? And use some weights in order to weight the probabilities for both the ASR output and the spelling correction output, spelling correction model output, right? That is the decoding part. Now let's jump into the experiments. I think I'm already running out of time. Let's just jump into the experiment. So what they like I said, they are targeting on correcting person names and spelling errors for English speaking personal assistant scenario, and they are using to generate the training scripts with context. They have 512 sentence patterns with the name tokens appear in each scenario, and 1 million training utterances are constructed combining, like I said, combining sentences, right, with the names, like I told you, okay, my name is something, I mean you put the name over there, something like that, right? And they use fast speech AM and LPC network coder for the TTC or text to speech, and with augmentation they also use 26 million in-house general transcript, which will not have any context words during training and so on, let's see the experiments. Number of layers and so on. So they are using RNNT model here, 1600 data units each layer, and they have 6 layers in the encoder and 2 layers in the decoder, and batch size, number of context each for each batch, and probability of the context. As I said, like you need to have normal sentences or general sentences as well. You can't simply use all the context sentences, so contextual phrases, sentences, right? And number of ASR hypothesis is 4, and the CSC decoder only generates 1 hypothesis. So okay, now let's look into the results. They have 3 different named data sets, V1, V2, V3, and this is the results for RNNT without any contextual spelling correction. As you can see, the word error rates are very bad, and as soon as you add CSC, you get huge improvement. Very big. I mean, the improvements here, like improve, as you can see, it's already what, like more than 10 or 12%, or I think it's almost 15% 15% absolute improvement in WR. This is like crazy, right? This is huge, and it happens for all the data sets, right? And this is again comparison with previous approaches. I mean, as you can see, if you don't use any for the name set, and this is for general set, there is not much change. I mean, that's fine. Whereas in case you have to look at the name set, I mean, when you have to look at the model and understand how good it is doing in case of contextual sentences or contextual sets, right? This is like very important. And without using anything, you get 30%, which is bad. I mean, right? So when you add contextual LM, like I said, you can create a language model using the contextual phrases, and then you can add it on the fly, right? And then do the decoding. It improves quite a lot. I mean, from 30% to 22%, which is good, right? And as soon as you add the CSC, which is the contextual spelling correction, your improvement will go from, your WR will go from 22, I mean, no, not 22, 30 to 16, which is like 15%. straight, almost 15% absolute improvement in WR. Compared to even the old method, like the contextual LM based method, is still a huge improvement, right? Almost 8% improvement, not 8, like 6% improvement, which is huge. This is about the runtime performance after you do teacher student training, right? So if you use the teacher as it is, the model size is 223 MB, and for Microsoft it's not a problem, for small companies it is a problem. And the WR is like 15%. When you do the knowledge transfer to the student, your model size reduces drastically. It comes to just 9.5 MB, which is great, and you lose 1% WR, 1% performance. That is okay, I guess, and latency also reduces. And if you don't do ranking, your runtime goes crazy, because you are going to use the entire context list, which is not so great, because obviously the computation time will be large. So that's why it's a good idea to use the ranker, which is going to select only the top few context phrases during decoding. And coming to another table here, they have different types of OOVs, different types in the sense they have three scenarios here: OOV 1, 2, and 3. So in case of OOV 1, these phrases will not be present in the training, and they'll be present only in the testing, right? For example, let's say Donald Trump, right? This is a phrase, and this phrase will not be present in training and only present in testing. That is OOV1. If this phrase is present in the training and this is not present during the testing, then is the OOV2, means only sub part of the context is present in the training, and other part will not be present in the training. And when this case happen, like for example, let's say there is another name, Donald Duck, for example, or Donald something, Donald Peter something, I don't know. So in those cases, the first word is in the training, but second word is not there, right? So those are the scenario. Third scenario is none of these words, like the no Donald, no Trump, is present in the training. Even the sub words, like the one words. So if they don't present, that's the OOV3. And this is without contextualization, right? And wherever you see, this is contextualization. As you can see, consistently you are getting very good performance. Like this is like going from 37 to 22. It's like great, right? And this is going from 43 to 27, 37 to 30, right? And if you use CSC, which is your spelling correction model, as you can see, the results are consistent, right? Like for both OOV1 and if whether you use contextualization or not. That's all for this tutorial. Thank you so much for watching, and if you like this video, please give a thumbs up. If you want to see this kind of tutorials, subscribe to my channel and press that bell icon. Thank you.